Thank you. My name is Sharon Barker, and I am an alcoholic.
Hi, Sharon.
And I don't know if you're going to hear a classy story or not. Whoops. Alcoholics Anonymous, you can really clean it up. It's really great. I was speaking at this little meeting in Malibu up at this retreat center. It was kind of a mellow meeting. I'm by a fireplace, and it was a participation and a topic. And I noticed this guy walked in late, and he stood in the back, and his arms were folded, and he had his hat on. And he said, "Well, come on in," you know. And he graced us with his presence and came in and sat down and listened. And after the meeting, he came up to me, and he said, "I have an amends to make to you." And I thought, "Oh, boy, I don't remember this guy at all," you know. This meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous, he thought, "What does that Beverly Hills housewife have to tell me?" You know, and so listen, you will not think I am a Beverly Hills housewife after I'm through, but I can clean it up. See, that's the beauty of it. I can walk out there with the best of them on the sunny side of the street, and I have no idea what my head is saying. Thank God. Because I still have a very loud alcoholic head. You know, the book talks a lot about how alcoholism centers in the mind, and boy, oh boy, it does. Because I physically have been sober for over 22 and a half years. So physically, I'm sober. You know, my body is sober, but my mind is still very active in alcoholism. So I need you together. You know, we can do it. Alone, I can't. I can sit in my room and read my big book and you know, have a good time, but there's something that happens when two or three are gathered together. So I'm glad we're all together this week, and I'm honored to be in the town of the Pulitzer Prize, you know, and people found out. Hey, it beats the floods and the, you know, the other stuff, right? I mean, when people found out I was going, they were all, you know, so it's like, it's great. I'm really proud of you and happy for you. You can't say no to a guy named Ole, you know, and sounds like a beer I used to drink or something. And then, you know, he gave me Carrie and Jim, and it just couldn't have been more fun. I mean, we've just had a lot of fun, and it's just beginning, and that's the joy of it is, it's Alcoholics Anonymous. I mean, I got up early, I got on the plane, I changed my seat, I'm sitting down next to this really nice couple, and we start talking, and, you know, and we talked a little bit, and then, you know, I slept a little bit, and then we talked a little bit more, and he kept throwing in these little phrases. So finally, I took my medallion out of my wallet and showed it to him, and he had 14 years, you know, and so it was like, oh, good, we had a meeting on the plane, you know, and it's so... You just never know. It's just been a really nice 24 hours so far. I mean, that's the joy of it. Alcoholics Anonymous offers me a day of peace and freedom and growth and power that is just an amazing thing that I never thought I would want this much life happening on a day-at-a-time basis. And I'm just so pleased and excited to be a member of Alcoholics Anonymous. I mean, we are the lucky ones. I read about this guy named Matt Talbot, who years ago lived in Ireland, and I'm sure somebody will correct me if I'm wrong, but because we do that to each other, lovingly, of course. And he was an alcoholic monk, and this was way before we had Alcoholics Anonymous. And when he would feel this obsession come upon him, he would have someone chained to this tree. He had this favorite tree. He would get chained to the tree, and then when he would say, "Okay, until I'm through frothing at the mouth," days later they would unchain him. And I mean, he died with chains that his body had practically, you know, absorbed in his. And that was, I mean, this is the easier, softer way coming into Alcoholics Anonymous and picking up a newcomer and saying yes to a request and saying a few prayers once in a while and making some amends and trying to live the good life. We could all be chained to the tree out there with the snow coming, you know, and that would be quite a sight. So I'm just really grateful that I live in the time and space of Alcoholics Anonymous. It's such a precious, precious gift. And, you know, we are the lucky ones. And I used to hear this speaker named Norm Alpe. He used to speak a lot in the Los Angeles area. And I was just, he would fire me up. And he used to talk about seconds and inches. And it's like, whoa, yeah. He said, just by seconds and inches that you are lucky to be here. You know, a lot of people, stone's throw from this meeting, may need Alcoholics Anonymous, may never know the inside of an Alcoholics Anonymous meeting, may never have a chance to come sit in a chair, hear Chapter 5, know they're not alone. And, you know, judge the coffee, judge the speaker, whatever we do, but, you know, have the knowledge that there is a way to go for his disease or her disease. And we are really the lucky ones, and it's just by seconds and inches. We've all got those places in our life where we ended up here instead of whatever the next answer was. So I am proud to be with the lucky ones tonight in Grand Forks. It's a privilege to be with you. I grew up in Iowa, my first resentment, but yeah, it was very, very close to this kind of community and sense of community, so I feel very at home here. But I fought that for a long time, and I am the only alcoholic in my family. I keep waiting for somebody, somewhere to fess up or, you know, come out of the closet or whatever their thing is, you know, but I'm it, so we're really glad we know what's wrong with me now. My parents wondered for a long time, gee, just meet a nice guy or get off those drugs, because, you know, it was the 60s. It wasn't just say no, it was just say thanks. You know, we had a lot of fun with our alcohol. But the first time I really got drunk, it did something for me. It empowered me. I had a spiritual dilemma going, and that it was a spiritual tool from that moment on. I mean, I sat on it was my neighbor's car, and I was with the neighborhood boys, and they just kind of drug me along, and I was a 13-year-old little flat-chested, you know, tag-along. And we're out there on an Iowa country road, and everybody's pulling up there, having a little woodsy, we used to call them. And, you know, and Canadian Club and Schlitz beer changed my life. I tell you, Marilyn Monroe slid off the top of that car, you know, that night. And my little bump stood right up there. I stood right up there. I just, you know, I drove cars, I danced, I told jokes, I chug-a-lug contest with the boys. I arrived, and the next day, being a good, nice little Catholic family, we went off to Mass, and I was hungover, and I felt bad, but I couldn't wait to do it again, because I remembered the magic of alcohol. It transformed my insides. I have a very loud head. It was always very loud, and we all got drunk. I mean, we got down to one big voice saying, let's party. I mean, we were all in unison. And that's what alcohol did for me. It got me real focused. And so when you find something that good, you just go for it. And I had really good grades, and I had the smoke screen going. I started leading a double life very early, very early. I started manipulating very early. I steeled your booze. I watered down your booze. I made it happen. I kept the party going. I blacked out. I had hangovers. It didn't matter. I was still in and out of that confessional in 30 seconds because it was a small town, and if you're in there longer than 30 seconds, you're a bad girl. So I had this image I had to keep up, and, you know, and I knew God would understand, you know, and I really wanted to be a nun at one time. I had aspirations, you know, and I had dreams. She's laughing. I wanted to be, she's laughing at me. She hasn't even heard me yet. She's laughing that I wanted to be a nun. But, you know, I guess what I wanted to do was have a purpose. I really wanted to have a purpose, and I wanted to be a United Nations translator. I mean, I had such big goals. So I'm the kind of person that I don't go from A to B to C to D, follow the steps to get to my goal. I want to go jumping right to Z. And if I can't do that, oh, who's going to want to, you know, I don't want to do that anyway. I didn't know how to live life. I was missing the day in school they gave out the rules of life. I just didn't have it. And see, I have something called pride, so I don't ask questions. I pretend like I know everything, and I'm a real good people pleaser, I'm a real good manipulator, I'm a real good game player, and I have good instincts with that kind of stuff. So I was able to fit in and follow along and be with some really bright people in my life and not learn a thing because I never asked a question. I would just act like I knew what they were talking about. You know, once in a while I'll throw in a, oh yeah, you know, or something. And I used to sit with Columbia University with the top of the top philosophy students, and, you know, I was just, you know, they had good hash and good wine, so that's why I was there. But yeah, I could have learned a lot, but I didn't. I didn't ask any questions. And it followed me into Alcoholics Anonymous, too. And this is a third edition big book, and there's a story on page, Dr. Paul has a story in here. And on page 449, it's something called acceptance, surrender, and that kind of stuff. And I had gotten sober in 75, so I had the second edition big book. Well, the third edition, I think, came out maybe 76 or 77. But people will tell me, oh, go home and read page 449. You know, you'll feel better. So I go home and I read my second edition big book, which was a story called Joe's Woes. And there's really nothing on it. I mean, I've looked on that page many times, and I would read it and go, okay, I'm missing something here. And I put it down, I read it again, and I wouldn't tell anybody. I don't get what I'm supposed to get on that page. Will you help me, please, you know? So finally, when I got a third edition big book, I learned a lesson. I just laughed out loud. I mean, it's like, ask questions if you're new. If you're new, ask a lot of questions. Nobody wants you. Believe me, we don't want you to know anything, you know. Just ask a lot of questions. But I had this pride going in my life, and I didn't ask questions. And I, after a while, began to believe my own press. You know, after a while, I began to believe I was doing okay. And alcohol fortified it. Went off to college, because you did that in my family. You got an education, and as I said, it was the 60s, and I was looking for truth, and there was a lot going on. And pretty soon, the sorority clothes went by the wayside. Pretty soon, I caught my man I was going to marry with another woman, and I wasn't very understanding. And I remember I got drunk, and I went down to confront him. And he twisted my arm because I was swinging at him, and put me on the floor so I calmed down. And I thought, no man is ever going to treat me like that, ever again. And as I tell you my story with alcoholism, where it took me with that, you know, I grew up in my parents are married, this July will be 57 years, God willing. You know, they live in the same house I grew up in. I come from stability. I come from love. I come from care. But alcoholism took all of that from me, and I gave pieces of my soul and my life freely for alcohol. I began taking geographics. My father and I had this big confrontation. I would occasionally wake them up in the middle of the night with my new truth I had found, drive in from the University of Iowa home and wake them up and knock on the door. And the night I changed my name, that was a good one, at 2 in the morning, I got them up and we're sitting at the kitchen table. And I mean, they think I'm probably married or something. They don't know why I have to wake them up. I have this thing I have to tell them. And I told them I changed my name to Cher. And and I said, it's not like Sonny and Cher, it's Share, because I share. You know, my dad looked at what I brought home that night that I was sharing with, so with the eyes spinning in his head and the dirty long hair and the no shoes on his feet, and he was real happy, I'll tell you. And, you know, I was beginning to take a lot of art classes, and I was drinking at Joe's place. I had a fake ID. I was... if there was a protest rally, I was there, because you give me a sign, some wine, and some uppers, and I'm real loud. And they just seemed to be having a lot of fun. And one day, my dad saw me on the news, the local news, and we had a talk, and then I tried to commit suicide because that was my answer. And the priest came down with my dad to talk to me about that, and we got drunk. The priest and I got real drunk that night. And my father sent me to a psychiatrist. They tried to help me. They had no idea that I was a budding alcoholic. You know, if Sharon could just meet some nice guy and get off those drugs. They had no idea that I was a budding alcoholic. And so after 2 years of college, I had this huge fight with my father, and that was it. You know, I told my dad exactly how I felt about him, his generation, how he lived his life, and I told him what I was doing with my life, exactly what I was doing with my life. I did not mince my words. And I broke my dad's heart. And, you know, there's three girls and a boy, and I'm the middle, I walk into a room with my fists up, you know, I'm the middle child, and I don't do that anymore. I put them at my side. But I'm competitive, and I need to prove myself, and I need to take a stand. And, you know, my dad played an accordion, so I played an accordion so that I could, you know, play my accordion with my father. And, I'll tell you, that wasn't much fun sitting on those hay wagons as we were having with those red dresses and those petticoats and my big Titano accordion, and hung over in this accordion band on a hay wagon going through a town because of a centennial parade. And they're the boys I was with the night before, and I have to move so they don't see me looking like Little Miss Accordion there on the hay wagon. And, oh, but, you know, I wanted to please my father, you know, and I drew pictures, and I painted pictures, and I was an art major, and I had a lot of talent, and that brought a lot of joy to my father. And And, you know, I broke his heart. And I ended up with my bags packed and I was in New York. And I didn't know I was taking geographics. I didn't know that's what I was going to do with my life. I thought, a fresh start, you know, it's a new place. And I was always from Wisconsin. I was never from Iowa, you know, because my accent gave me away. But, you know, Wisconsin had cheese. Iowa had pigs. I felt like a pig. I couldn't be from Iowa. I mean, it just, I was beginning to kind of cut off who I was just because I was never enough. I was never enough. I had to have this fantasy going. And I ended up in New York. And you know, Norm Alpe also used to tell me, well, I mean, that's a piece of truth. I took a lot of hits of, you know what, to look for truth with all my booze because I had to find it. And when I'd find it, but I'd forget where I left it. So I never found truth until I came to AA. But, you know, Norm Alpe used to talk about the reason the grass is greener. You know, it was like I came to AA and I heard truth. You know, he said it's because the other guy took care of his lawn. It was like, oh, yeah. You know, it made sense to me. I wanted to sit on your lawn. I wanted to go, you know, put my fingers through your dichondra because you've worked for it, you know, and you've worked hard at it. But I just want to sit and enjoy it because mine is barren. I am barren. I am barren inside. I am not able to draw anymore. I went back to college. I couldn't draw anymore. There was no more talent left. And I don't know if I was sitting in the West End bar in Upper Manhattan and the bartender said, gee, if you drink like this tonight and act like this, you're not going to draw another picture for 25 years. You're not going to want to paint another picture. You're going to be frustrated and not be able to paint another picture for 25 years. That part of you that makes you special is going to go away. I'd say double it and serve me. Because alcohol was more powerful than what I was or what I thought that I needed to have to live in life. Alcohol was my answer. When I couldn't draw anymore or paint anymore, I was very depressed. I had another fight with my father, and I ended up in Colorado. And, you know, and I don't know if I would have been sitting at the Mountain Man Bar in near Aspen, Colorado, and the bartender would have said, you know, if you act like this tonight and drink like this tonight, your dignity is gone. And I would have said, you know, double it. Buy him one, too. You know, I didn't know he was married. Sorry. You know, I just, I just acted badly, and I met Bob Dylan and I came to California. And anyway, I think it was Bob Dylan. Sang like Bob Dylan. I ended up living in a commune. I didn't have two quarters to rub together, but I was free. I would work for my wine at this little festival, and I'd drink wine and sell this guy. He was a speed freak. He'd be in the back painting these pictures really fast, and I'd be drinking my wine. I'd have my bells on my ankles, and I'd be meditating and flowers in my hair, and people would come up and buy, and I'd be real mellow, and they'd buy these little speed freak pictures for me, and I was happy. I mean, I was free. I turned 21 dancing with the Krishnas. They wanted me. You know, I had been to the Pentecostals. They wanted me. I had been almost dunked by the Jesus Freaks in Laguna. They wanted me. You know, I had this hole in my psyche or something. They just spot me. You know how I'd walk into a room and the sickest person would always find me. I mean, it's just like, how do they do it, you know? And I'd be walking down the street and these people would just light up when they saw me. And you know, they had something. I knew I was missing something that they had. They had a sense of purpose. They had a sense of spirit. They always wanted me forever. They wanted eternity or something. And I'd say, no. I live a day at a time, and I'd have to pick up my backpack and go, always. But I knew they had something I was missing, but I couldn't commit. I couldn't commit to anybody or anything. And finally, the commune tapped me on the shoulder and said, you got to go. And I hated that. I hated getting found out. I hated being 1 minute overdue at your house. I hated not being needed. My instinct was sleeping, you know, and it tapped me on the shoulder, and I ended up sticking my thumb out, and me and the dog they gave me, and so me and Tar Baby headed back to Colorado, and, you know, I did a lot of that kind of behavior by myself or with you, or, you know, I thought I was so free. I mean, I marched on Washington for freedom. I went to all the peace rallies. I went to the moratoriums. And, you know, if there was a cause, I had to feel like I was a part of it. But I was there to get high. I really was more interested in what you were drinking and what you were taking than the purpose of why we were really there, other than freedom, you know, freedom. I thought the less I had encumbering me in life, I was free, and I was a prisoner of alcoholism. I had no idea, none. I ended up back with my mother and father. My mother said I could stay there as long as I didn't take any drugs in the house, and so I went into the taverns in that small town in Mount Vernon, Iowa, and drank. And I was depressed, and I knew something was deeply wrong with me. I knew, I hit my knees in my little room that I grew up in, and I said, you know, God, I don't know what's wrong with me, but help me. And my help came in the form of somebody who said they'd take care of me, and that was my next answer, because I was awfully tired of taking care of myself. My dad and I couldn't even ride in the same car at the same time. That was the Thanksgiving my parents and my family, when we went to my grandmother's house, I sat with the children at the card tables in the other room because they were afraid of how I was going to act or what I was going to say. They didn't know alcoholism. They didn't know it. And, you know, I'm so grateful that my grandmothers and my one grandfather got to see me sober before they passed on. I'm so grateful for that. And that my parents could sleep at night because of you. I'm overpaid. You know, I really, when I think about it, you know, it's not a big deal to answer the phone and talk to a newcomer at 1 in the morning. It's not a big deal to give you a ride. It's not a big deal to go share at a prison. It's not a big deal to get on a plane and come here and be with you and be treated really, really well. You know, it's not a big deal to say yes to Alcoholics Anonymous. I am overpaid. And I hope I always remember that debt that I have, because it keeps it fresh in my mind. I do not want to go back to that broken-spirited shell of a human being that walked in here on August 20th, 1975. I do not. I want to remember it. And, you know, I ended up at Northern Wisconsin Organic Farm. That was their answer to helping me. Now, I didn't have a functioning gallbladder. I had pancreatitis, and we didn't know any of this, so they just took away my cigarettes, they took away my alcohol, and they gave me organic pot to smoke. And so I smoked organic pot. I did all this Adele Davis organic eating. We were in northern Wisconsin. We would come into Minneapolis to the West Bank, and we would buy all our organic food at this co-op, and we would drive back to this organic farm with organic maple trees that we tapped in the winter. It was a lot of work. And these organic honeybees, and that was a lot of work. And this 50 head of organic sheep that, you know what they make, that was a lot of work. And I painted mailboxes, and I smoked my organic pot, and I read my Mother Earth News, and I still wasn't getting better, and they took me in emergency, and they had to run a couple of tests, and the doctor said to me, your gallbladder isn't functioning, you have pancreatitis, do you abuse drugs or alcohol? And I said, I'm organic. And that was as honest as I could be. And he was the first one, looking back, that spotted something about me. I was real sick, and so I went through some surgery, and I got better, and I remember the second snowfall, and I remember sitting there smoking my organic pot and rocking in my chair and reading my Mother Earth News, and he was across the room with that five-string banjo, and he kept missing that fifth string, and he would start the record over, Pete Seeger, how to play the banjo with Pete Seeger, you know, and he'd start it over, and I didn't have a TV for diversion. There was no diversion. You know, and I just flew out of that chair, and I went into town, their town. It was a general store, Connersville. And I plopped down my quarters and got some cheap wine and came home, and I felt better. And I got roaring drunk. And I remember he woke up at 4 in the morning, and I'm having, me and the dog and the cat are having a great time. We're partying, you know. I've got relief going, finally. And he gave me that look, you know, that look. We've all seen that look, and you Al-Anons have given that look, you know. It's and I always read it as a judgment, but what it really was, you know, boy, they don't understand us at all, you know, and confusion and compassion. But I saw that look at him, so, I read it, of course, as a judgment, because I'm a rebel, and my head said, loud and clear, alcohol is more fun than you. And it took me a while to get rid of them. Actually, I was blackballed from that organic community up there, and I was left alone with my 50 head of sheep and my cheap wine and my friend Clarence, the farmer, who'd bring the hard stuff. And he would bring his tractor because he had his license pulled for too many DWIs, so he was on the tractor. And he'd go get the hard stuff and come at night, and we drank. And then I think his wife went to Al-Anon, took away the keys to the tractor, and then I was really alone. And I had this half acre of organic marijuana that I was pruning and having a good time with all summer long, and I harvested it and put it in hefty bags by horseback. It took me 3 days, and I went into town to this 45 miles into Menominee to turn this big dope deal so I could get out of town because winter's coming, and I was so cold that winter. I said, never again, never again. And I forgot the dope, and it was, there happened to be a carnival in town, so of course, I wanted to be a gypsy, and I went over there, and they happened to have a job opening, and I happened to qualify because I drank like they drank. I mean, that was my interview, was sitting there with a bottle of tequila. And so I packed up my pot and some clothing and stuck my dog in there, and I had this big old car in Cheshire. See, you have to name these cars. They last longer. And bald tires, big sun painted on the hood. I should have written bust me on the side, you know, but... We joined the carnival, and I ran the shooting gallery, and I left. I left the house full of my mother's antique furniture, those 50 head of sheep, that horse, my cat. You know, I am just looking ahead because, you know, tough. You know, it really just hurt too much to turn around and look behind me. I didn't want to see the disappointment one more time in anybody's face. It just, you know, who needs them? And I ended up somewhere in Arkansas calling my mother, telling her what I had done, and then my mother cries. I can't talk to my dad, now my mother cries. My mother had to drive from eastern Iowa up to northern Wisconsin to take care of all of that stuff. But I'm not hurting anybody but myself, and that's my selfish, self-centered, self-obsessed alcoholic cry. Leave me alone, I'm not hurting anybody but me. Crap. That's crap. When an alcoholic takes a drink, the statistics are, which I think it's light, that 10 other people are affected. And I believe that there's a lot more than 10 other people, but I'm not hurting anybody but myself because I am selfish. I am prideful. I am empty. And the only thing that will still work for me is alcohol. I had a list a mile long of why I drank like I did and why I did what I did. And if you asked me about it, I'd tell you. And these guys drank hard and heavy, and I had the pot, and they had the uppers, and we were instant friends, and my nice dog started to bite people even. I mean, we just got mouth slipped to the side, cowboy boots came on, tequila was right there on my shooting gallery, you know, and, you know, I just ripped. I just ripped through those towns, and, oh, boy, if you're keeping track of my life, there's amends that have to be made along the way here, and I guess I would have maybe acted better if I would have known. I don't know, but you know, the way I made amends for that carnival, it's kind of a serendipitous thing. If you stay sober long enough, things present themselves. You know, I know a lot of people have a hard time making amends to dead people, you know, and what's necessary to be done is sponsors have walked me through some of that and healing has happened with the amends. But the carnival was one way. I just kind of blew it out of my mind, and I was sober about 5 years, and I'm standing at one of our meetings one night, and this nun comes up to me that I know that's been sober a little while, and she said, you know, I need a new sponsor. Would you be my sponsor? And I went, this is a nun asking me to be her sponsor. Oh, sure, glad to. You know, I thought, what's this all about? And I just gave this nun a 17-year birthday cake last Wednesday, and she's just been an incredible... mate along this road in the sponsor baby relationship and spiritual tools that she's given me and that she says I've given her, and I think she's helped me a lot more and I've helped her. But see, she was principal of this school for many years, and when she asked me to sponsor her, she was principal of this school, and my son at that time had just kind of been kicked out of kindergarten at another place, so I sent him over to her, and so he started kindergarten at St. Augustine's, and guess what they have every spring? A school carnival. And we have so many service hours we have to do as a you know, parent of a child going to school. So I would work this school carnival, and I was there maybe a couple of years before I went, well, gee, maybe I could make some amends here. Since it was mostly children I ripped off, I thought, let me buy some ride tickets for the kids. So I started buying ride tickets for the kids, and every year that little group that gathers around me as I go out to the ride booth, there she is, you know, gets bigger, you know. there's Wesley's mom. She's going to buy us tickets. Come on, you know? And it's like they've gotten bigger. And I've got one more year. He graduates from eighth grade this year. So one more year. I don't know if there's going to be 20 or 30 of them this year, but I'm probably going to, you know, lay a C-note down there and buy some ride tickets. And maybe that amend will be made. I don't know. But, you know, there's ways that life affords you to make amends, to clean yourself out, to clear away the past, so that there can be more room for the new. And the new includes you, and the new includes God, and the new includes just new awarenesses, which is so exciting. I know if you're new, I'm probably losing you, so that's okay. But let me just say one thing. If you're new, make your feet your friend. Don't make your head your friend. And, you know, because your feet will get you to your sponsor's house. Your feet will get you to a meeting. If you watch your feet, they'll get you out of bed to your job. You know, they'll walk by the liquor store. Watch those feet, but put your mind in the trunk of your car for about a year. Just lock it in the trunk of your car. You know, I don't care if you go to a foot masseuse, you know, pedicure your toes. You know, love them, but your feet will get you where you need to go, but your head will not. So go back to sleep now. So, but I got busted for drugs at this carnival, and I think I got pointed out. I think somebody said, we're tired of her act. You know, she started a fight in the Midway in Monroeville, and, you know, we get closed down early, and she's just trouble, and so, you know, I've got a tip for you, you know, Bogalusa, Louisiana Parish. And so I woke up to shotguns that morning in my belly, and they wouldn't let me get dressed, and they searched the room, and they found enough for possession and sales, so it was a felony. And so I went to jail, my dog went to jail, my new friend went to jail, and he had a pet skunk, so the skunk went to jail. We all went to jail, and there I am, the carnival leaves town. I'm in maximum security in Bogalusa, Louisiana. That was not a chapter in the book I was writing. I really went a little crazy. I managed to find somebody making his own very bad apple wine, but I managed to get drunk in jail. And I had been in there about a week before they slapped some handcuffs on, took me to this building, and, you know, threw me out of the car and put me in. There was my father. He had come into town and found out what had happened to me. I called my brother-in-law. I wasn't going to call my father. My one phone call was to my brother-in-law. And he had called my father. My father had found me and taken a plane, taken a bus, rented a car, whatever, and came and hired this lawyer. And I sat there in handcuffs, a disheveled mess, because I didn't bathe in there either, because the one time I took a shower, they all watched. And it was just, you know, one of those, I kind of blocked it all out of my memory. But I remember sitting there next to my dad that day. And we were inches away from each other, shoulder to shoulder, sitting in these chairs looking at this attorney behind this big desk. And I don't remember much about that day other than nobody said, gee, I'm sorry, or nobody said, you're an alcoholic, or nobody said, what's wrong with you? Or I asked my dad, at their 50th anniversary, we had a really nice talk when I went home. And I said, Dad, you know, that day is a day I need some clarification on. You know, what did I say that day? He said, you told me you weren't guilty. It wasn't your fault. It's like, not my fault. I've got a list a mile long as to why I act the way I act. And I was arrogant and prideful, and my father and I didn't hug each other that day. And, you know, he didn't say, you know, your mother and I worry about you. And it was just, he hired this guy to try to get me out of this jackpot. And it didn't work, and I ended up paying a big fine, but I did not do more than 31 days. And I ended up with a felony in my record, and I ended up finding New Orleans, and I had to pay this fine, and I danced on Bourbon Street, and I drank on Bourbon Street, and I passed out on Bourbon Street, and I fell in love with the French Quarter, and I met some people there that were just like me, that drank just like me, that didn't judge my drinking, that drank harder and heavier than me, and I became a bartender, and we all watched out for each other, and I would have 2 and 3 day blackouts, and you know, I would come to at the same bar, and they would have taken care of me. My purse would have been put on the other side of the bar. I would have a tab, because you came to my bar, you had a tab, and I took care of you. And or a cab driver would find me, and he'd say, you know, I took you home the other day. You owe me a fare. You were, you know, kind of wedged between a car and the curb, and so we all kind of took care of each other. And this guy that I had gotten busted with, we were in this thing now forever, you know. We hated each other. We were in love for 2 weeks and hated each other for 2 years. And I want to tell you about this relationship because I didn't grow up with this kind of behavior, you know. He was a heroin addict, which I never understood. You know, anybody face down going, let's party, was not part of my repertoire. I like to move fast and go and drink tequila and ride Harleys and, you know, shake my fist and peace sign in one and finger in the other. And, you know, I could never decide what I was going to do. Am I going to love you or slug you or, you know, play George Jones? If I was drinking gin and playing George Jones, they all left, you know. Man, they didn't want to be with me. And but yet we were all alcoholics in this, and so we seemed to forgive each other, and we seemed to kind of take care of each other. And this guy, my parents came and found me. And my mother was the only one talking to me because my father couldn't. He had that set look in his face, and that jaw was tight, and he would catch me out of the corner of his eye, and I'd catch him out of the corner of my eye, and there was such pain between me and Dad. There was never any physical abuse, but there was so much pain between me and Dad. You know, I had a new black eye that day, and you know, that's the way we live. We live with knife fights and insanity, and that skunk and the snake was loose, and, you know, the dog got killed by a car, and I was sitting in a hotel with my dead dog. I couldn't believe this dog was dead, and, you know, all my animals used to bite the dust. My turtles would crawl through my cocaine, and I'd find them stiff, you know, and, it's, you know, you didn't want to hang around me because you weren't sure, you know, if you were going to come to the next day or not, but that's the way my parents found daughter number two, you know. And he wasn't nice to me in front of my parents, and he called me lots of names. And I went and sat down at the Mousetrap Bar and ordered my rock glass full of gold. And I drank it, and I drank more, and I drank more, and I drank more, and it didn't put out the fire when they went home that day. And I knew that it was over with me and the family. It was a day that I remember alcohol not working for me. I needed it to work for me. And I knew if I went home with my mother and wrapped her little sweater around me and laid in the back of that station wagon and went back to Mumford and Iowa, nothing would change. And I didn't know alcoholism. I didn't know alcoholism, and neither did they. And I worked my way down to Lower Decatur Street. I came to once in Florida. I had moved there with people I didn't know. I said, I got to take better care of myself and my blackouts. You know, I was beginning to end up way out in the bayou, and I was getting in cars with people I was hitchhiking that were, you know, come back and try to catch me with their shotguns laying in a field of palmetto bushes, and when the sky rained and they left. And I was getting in situations that were getting more and more violent, and I began to not even care. Now, as a girl in high school, I could be whatever I wanted to be growing up. You know, I tested so that I could be whatever I wanted to be growing up, you know. And by the time I was a senior in high school, I didn't have any aspirations to go develop a cure for cancer or to be of service down in Peru or whatever. I wanted to be a truck driver. I mean, my drinking and alcoholism had taken away my dreams one by one by one by one. But I was free, see? I was free. I had no attachments, and I was free. And in 1975, my friend Michael was shot and killed. A lot of those people I drank with are dead. Michael had a gun. A policeman shot him. He was shooting at people off my balcony in Mardi Gras Day. I had been fired from my job on Lower Decatur Street, which is in a nice part of the tourist section of the French Quarter. You can smell the bathroom as you walk in the front door. It's not a place you and my alcoholic friends wanted to come visit and drink with me. And they fired me for having a bad attitude. And I was partying on Mardi Gras Day with Michael, and I was 2 feet inside the door when I came out of a blackout, and Michael was dead to my left. And, you know, that's seconds and inches. And I ran to New York because I felt like anybody or anything around me now is just doomed. And I kept putting myself in situations where maybe it would be over for me because I didn't have the guts to commit suicide. I really didn't even think of that. I just knew it was going to be over soon, and I knew that I wasn't going to hit 25, and which I did. And when I hit 25, I was just waiting. I was waiting for it to happen. And I ended up coming to California, where I first saw the Big Book in this bar, Barney's Deanery. This girl was so drunk that they had to call her a taxi to go to her A&A meeting. And we all took our drinks and cheered her on out the door, you know. And her name was Chris Running, and she was going to be my Eskimo to Alcoholics Anonymous. And I had no idea had no idea. I ended up back in New Orleans, and I couldn't get a job. It seemed like nobody wanted to be with me. I seemed to be the loser of the alcoholic bunch down there, and I met someone going to Hawaii, and I was on my way again back west. And I think I had some DTs and scared the guy a little bit, and he left some money on the bar in Barney's Beanery, and never saw him again. And I ended up on a Harley Davidson going to Palm Springs. I had been unemployable. I tried the cocktail waitress. They asked me to go after 10 minutes because I couldn't remember where the drinks went. I was sleeping in that girl, Krista. She was moving out, and I was sleeping in her living room where there was no furniture. And I remember crawling across the floor one night, and I opened this book that was Came to Believe. It had a little sprout coming out of the snow. I liked the cover of this book. And I couldn't go out until it was night because I was paranoid, and I would hide all the way down to the liquor store. I would make it to the bar, and, you know, I would have you buy me drinks for whatever, and ended up going to Palm Springs on a Harley, you know, and I was over 170 pounds, and I wore a red dashiki and a Panama hat, and I had splotches on my face, and physically I wasn't doing well. When we got to this nightclub, these guys left, and as they were leaving, I said, I thought we were going to party, and they said, we just needed some extra weight. You know, it was windy going through the desert, so we looked around Barney's and found the fattest one, and it was you. Thanks very much. And they roared off on their Harleys, and I immediately met the bar boys, and I went into a blackout, and I don't remember much about that evening, except when I came to, I was in an apartment where they were really physically hurting me, and this wasn't a DT, and this really was happening, and my surrender happened that night. It was July 27th, 1975. I stopped screaming. And my pride left, and my fight left, and my survivor just kicked in, because we're all survivors. We all have that little bit of God in us to get us in the doors of AA, every single one of us. I hold that so dear. And I came to us at the bottom of a ravine, and I had a broken jaw in three places, and my nose was broken. And I remember the car door slamming, and I remember I came to. I had a concussion, and I thought they were coming back, and that survivor kicked in. And I heard a voice, and the voice said, "Get up, I want to live." And I really believe that God has a window of opportunity, maybe just a minute nanosecond in our life, where he gets our attention. And that's our surrender. Hang on to that. Work with the newcomers. You know, see it in their eyes. Let that surrender happen again and again, because I don't ever want to go back to laying on a ravine. And that's where I start. It's not any pretty champagne anymore. It's not drinking in Paris. It's not, you know, looking for truth. I start at the bottom of a ravine. So I'm really grateful that I went through what I had to go through to get to Alcoholics Anonymous. I laid in that hospital, and I was the victim. They caught these guys. The police were there. In front of my name was the word victim. And if my broken face could have smiled, I would have smiled, because, yes, I have an identity. That's what I was shooting for, victim. And I was in there for 2 weeks, and nobody sent me an airline ticket. And that was God working. Nobody bailed me out, and that was God working. And I lived above a liquor store, and we had to go back because I had to go to court. I had to go back to these doctors because my face was wired together and I didn't want to look too bad, so I was afraid, and I was tired. And this guy that knew the girl from Barney's Beanery felt sorry for me and said I could stay there for a while, and he would buy me red wine, go to work, and I would stick a straw in the red wine, stick a straw through the wires in my mouth where the tooth had been, and I would drink my liquid diet. And alcohol wasn't fun anymore, and alcohol wasn't working anymore, and there was no more freedom, and there was no more, let's go start over in Phoenix, or I was dead. It was over. And I called my mother, because he said, "You got to go. You're depressing me." The tap on the shoulder again. And I called my mother, and I had this broken jaw, and I could hardly talk to her, and I said, "Mom, I need some help. I need some money. I need to stay here." And she said, "Sharon, And my mother had gotten this panic phone call from someone in the emergency room, and they had told her what had happened to me, but they didn't tell her where I was. So it took my sister in New York and my mother in Iowa 2 days of making phone calls to find me and to find out I was going to be okay. And when I called my mother on August 20th and I asked her for some money and some help, my mother said words. She said, "Sharon, I can't help you anymore. You better go to the Salvation Army. And if she would have sent $20, you'd have another speaker." And I know that in my heart. And I called a number that was sitting in front of me, and it was that girl, Chris. The girl that had been in the bar, the girl that we had to call a cab to go to her ANA meeting. And I called Chris because she was always nice to me, because she had let me sleep on her floor once. And Chris said she recognized alcoholism because she was one of us. She wasn't sober that day, but she got me to someone who was. And I had no idea that the miracle of coming to the doors of Alcoholics Anonymous was beginning to work in my life that day. I had no idea. Because she gave me this woman named Suzanne, and she threatened not to give me the phone number unless I called. And so she kind of baited me. And she was good with me. She was like me. And I called this woman named Suzanne, and I had to talk like this. You know, Suzanne, I'm sure, she said, I didn't know what I had on the phone, but she said to me, "Put down your drink and put down your joint." And I thought, how does she know I had both? Instantly read my mail. And what happened was, she said, "Go sit by the steps and these girls are going to come get you." And so I sat by the steps and waited for these girls. And these beautiful girls got out of this car, California blondes, big teeth, big eyes. They started clean, pretty, you know. And I said, "No, no, no, no." But my body got up and went with them because I had no other answers. And I sat in the back of their car, and it was a Volkswagen, and you couldn't roll down the windows. It was August 20th. It was hot. I was detoxing. I don't know when the last bath I took was. Water began to hurt. That's all I remember. You know, it wasn't important anymore. My friend Mary Ann, who's got 25 years in our group, said, "I saw you at Ohio Street one night, and the light was on your hair," and I nudged my friend Pat and said, "Look, maybe Sharon will make it. She washed her hair." I had no idea that that's how I came to you. No idea. Everything about who I am today is a direct result of my surrender and the love of the people in Alcoholics Anonymous and a God that came into my life again. I ended up at this meeting at this church, and I thought, "Oh, God, here we go. They're going to have to, you know, want me forever, and they're going to, you know, they're going to make me sit in the kitchen because I look so bad, and, you know, this man standing at the door." I liked your greeters tonight. I really appreciate that. He was standing at the door. He was the secretary of the meeting. He had on a tie. He looked nice. He was handsome. He stuck out his hand, and I thought he was going to put me in the kitchen behind him. And, you know, "Oh, my God, you can't come in here looking like that." You know, that's what my head said walking up to the door. And what the man did was take away all my defenses by saying one word, and the word was welcome. And it means so much. It means so much to be welcome to Alcoholics Anonymous. Because I was lost and frightened, and I had no idea where I was coming. They sat me in front. I don't know how they knew I was new. I had no idea. "You can smell me at the door. Oh, there's a newcomer in the room tonight," you know. I think in the last number of years, I mean, luckily we've had a lot of places where people get to go and detox and take care of themselves, and they come a day and they smell nice, they look nice, so you can't tell. And a couple of months ago, but I think that's changing too. We're going to start seeing a few more seizures in the meetings. My friend is carrying his wooden spoon around ready to go, you know, and we're going to actually get 12-step calls again instead of, you know, insomniacs. And so I think it's the tide is turning again. But you know, when Alcoholics Anonymous, it's the joy that was that when I came to you, you know, I looked like an alcoholic, I smelled like an alcoholic, and you were happy, you know. Look at her. Maybe she'll make it, you know. And a couple months ago, a baby of mine ran up to me at the Wednesday night meeting, which is a big meeting. We have all the home groups meet on Wednesday nights. It's 1,100 people. It's a great meeting. It's run very well, but she said, "Oh, my God, somebody over there has been drinking." You know, it's like, hello, this is Alcoholics Anonymous, you know. I said, "Let's go over and talk to him." But she was frightened. She hadn't had that experience, you know. I got sober in 75, and I know there's some people here that have some time. And I had real 12-step calls. I ended up in seedy hotels in Inglewood with a woman with the black eye, and the guy passed out next to her, and I drug her off to meeting. And I know she came to with a big book and literature going, "What have I done?" You know, but I stayed sober. It was so good for me. You know, I was so grateful to be a B on the list because I got called quickly. It was before computers. They just went through the Rolodex, you know, and I think we're going to get to see that again. So hang on. It's going to get exciting again. And you know, when I came to you, I got, you know, I had this wire jaw, so I couldn't talk the first 3 months I was here, so I had to learn to listen. It was really a blessing in disguise. And people would call me kid a lot, and I had no money and no place to stay, so they gave me a sleeping bag. They moved me out of the liquor store. You know, me and my second edition big book that I gave this guy my last quarter for, because I don't want to owe you anything, because I'm a scorekeeper. You know, and I paid him back a quarter, but every other week he said, you were the only one who ever paid me back for a big book my whole term. But I don't want to owe you anything, and people give me rides or money or clothes out of their closet, you know, and I would write it down. I had this little spiral notebook, and one night this man named Chuck, who died with 32 years of sobriety last year, wonderful man, gentle man, said, what are you doing? And so I'm a broken jaw, so I just talked to him and show him what I was doing and who I had to pay back for this and that, and he says, no, kid. And they call me kid a lot. And, yeah, but he was a nice man, so I didn't tell him what I thought of him. And he said, someday you're going to have a car, and you'll be able to give somebody a ride to a meeting. Someday you're going to have a little job, and you can slip $10 into that person's purse when they need it. You'll be able to buy groceries and leave it by somebody's door. You might even clean out your closet and have some extra clothes that a newcomer could use. Pass it along. That's the way we want to be paid back. So get rid of that little book. And I didn't know what happened to me. I mean, it's looking back now, was he gave me back a big piece of my dignity. And it was very loving, kind ways that people in Alcoholics Anonymous treated me like that. I remember the first time I told a lie. And it was to my friend Ramon. Ramon couldn't speak, he was Mexican, but he couldn't speak Spanish, he couldn't speak English. We didn't know what he would say. But he was real spiritual, but he loved him. Whatever he said, we all went, yeah, you know, it was... And he just had a way of looking right through you, you know. And he said this thing to me one night, and I complimented my watch. And I said, oh, yeah, my grandfather gave that to me. And it was a lie, my grandfather, Wesley. And because I was too drunk to go say goodbye to my grandfather, Wesley, when he was dying in the hospital. So I always made up this lie about this watch that he had given it to me. And I told that to Ramon, and I walked away, and I went, light went on, that's a lie. Oh, well. He doesn't know. He didn't have to know. Not everybody needs everything about me. If I'm walking around the room once, I'd go by Ramon again, twice. Well, maybe I should tell him. No, he doesn't care. What does he care? Work his own program. You know, as I'm going around the room, my head's yakety-yakety-yak. I don't know, maybe the fourth time I stopped and I said, Ramon, you know what? You know, before I could say anything, he said, yeah, I know, it was a lie. He said, it's okay, I love you anyway. It's okay. You know, you came back and you talked to me about it. And that was, it was like, oh my God, I can start my day over at 11 o'clock. I don't have to wake up with a brain tumor. And, you know, I called my sponsor once when I had the headache and I was a food waitress. They wouldn't let me bartend. And, oh my God, I had the worst attitude until the Queen Al-Anon showed me how to do this. So just get one of these and hot coffee and shut up when they ask you how you are. Don't tell them. They don't want to know. Don't bring them down. You're a waitress. Give them service. The people in AA didn't want to sit in my station anymore. It was so bad, you know? So they did this, and the tips got better. So it was really great. But, you know, what happened was, you know, I learned how to change my behavior before I could change my thinking, thank God. And that's where the freedom comes for me. I don't have to listen to this. And I called my sponsor with my brain tumor that morning, and first of all, do not call your sponsor at 6 a.m. to whine. Not a good idea. Especially Janet. She wasn't the morning person. She was not a morning person. And I called her, and I told her I have a brain tumor, and I'm going to stay home. And she said, you know what? If you die at home in bed, no funeral. But if you die at that coffee shop, working your program, we're going to give you a great send-off. Lots of flowers, say great things about you. Now go to work, and she hung up on me. And I was like, ooh, she made me so mad. I went out, and I was a perfect member of AA that day just to prove her wrong. So that rebel worked kind of for me. I've learned to let the rebel work for me. It's a motivator in my life. couple years ago, I called my older sister, the Mensa, the brilliant one, you know, the one I had to follow in school that was like, she read so I didn't read. Who hurts? I hurt, you know. I started reading Shakespeare in my sobriety, you know, because I hadn't read any of that, you know, Huck Finn, you know, because she read. I wasn't going to read. You know, I got the call a couple years ago. I said, Nancy, thank you for making me competitive. It has helped me in my life. I just don't put my fists up anymore, you know. But I have a competitive spirit that is a motivator. That is a wonderful thing for me when I use it as part of my character and it doesn't become selfish and part of my defect. You know, I'm basically the same person I was when I was born. There is everything in me that I need to get by in life in a very, very wonderful fashion. I just have to know how to work my program to clean out the crap so I can sort the good from the bad, because I think I have my head figured out and they change clothes in the middle of the night, so I don't even try. I don't even try. My feet are still pedicured. I get a massage every other week and I make sure she works on my feet. I love my feet. My feet are still my friend, and there's many times I have to lock my head in the trunk of my car and just show up and be of service and be a member of Alcoholics Anonymous whether you're looking or not. I'm an example of AA whether they know it or not. I used to take the freeway to work. I don't do that anymore. I don't need to. I don't know why I ever did. Test my serenity, I think. But driving is one area I had to really surrender. And something about a steering wheel in my hand gave me a sense of false power. And I was on my way to work. I had a great morning. I had walked with my dog. I was feeling really good. And this little old lady cuts me off. She's in something like a Valiant or something. I don't even make them anymore. And, you know, she had her little blue hair on, and it was a hot summer day, and she was, you know, listening to K-Joy, which is like elevator music, you know. And she's kind of singing along, and she cut me off. Who does she think she is? So I am like, you know, I give her the look, and then I give everybody the look on the freeway. Get out of my way, I give you the look. You're in my way, I give you the look. You know, my spiritual tools are gone. I am like into self. And I get to my off-ramp. I'm sweating. My suit is wrinkled. You know, forget what I just read in my daily reflections. You know, that's out the window. I'm into revenge now. And I get to my off-ramp, and who's ahead of me? The little old lady in her Valiant. Not one little blue hair out of place, singing and whistling to her little K-Joy still. I laughed. I burst into laughter because it was such a wonderful lesson. And there's so many ways through the forest. There's just so many ways. You've tread a path for me, and you said, this is the way. These are the 12 steps. This is the path. This is the easier way. Now, there's brambles over there. Go get hung up for a while, but, you know, please stay within shouting distance, or we'll never find you again. I want to stay smack in the middle of this thing in Alcoholics Anonymous, because every day I'm sober, every day I'm sober, I have more of an understanding of life and that God loves me and that I'm one of God's kids. And that, yes, there is work to be done, but it's just a hallway, for God's sake. Quit whining about being in the hallway. Because when the new door opens, it's a beautiful view you've never seen before. Enjoy growth. Enjoy the hallway. Ask somebody else, why are you in the hallway? Why are you in pain? Take your blinders off a while. Thank God, in my mansion of life, there have been so many beautiful views, and I just keep going through it. God keeps leading me through it, and the door always opens if I stay sober. Always to a more beautiful view. And that's the freedom that inside I just keep going deeper and fuller and better and higher. And, you know, I remember when my sponsor, I got a year of sobriety, I drew her a picture. And I wrote this thing, when you climb to the top of the mountain at the top of the world, don't look down, grow wings. You know, and I learned how to trust. I had done that third step with her. I thought I was gay after the third step because she hugged me for a long time and it felt good. And then I made this decision, I must be gay. That was my first third step. I was not out here for a long time. She said, let's don't make any major decisions in our first year. So I worked on my inventory, and I trusted her with it finally, because my friend Pat, who had 8 days less than me, came in and stole my thunder in this group. I've been in the same group since I got sober. And she came in, her husband died of cancer. They had to push her through the steps. She had to make her amends because, you know, she just had to. Plus, she looked nicer than me. She had a job. She smelled nicer. The old-timers wanted to work with her. I was working with people in their first year at various stages of insanity, you know. I didn't know any better, but they were hoping I was going to make it, but they were hoping they didn't have to get too involved. I can tell you that much. And so what happened was Pat had done her inventory way before me. And I was thinking, you know, that wine looks awful good over there on that table next door. Or I deserve a little relief. And then Pat would pop in my mind. You know, then you'll have less time than Pat, you know. Pat kept me sober for a while, but it seemed like every time they read chapter 5, she would look at me, thin little blue lips. I've done my inventory. I know you haven't done your inventory, you know. And, oh, so mad. And finally, a week before my first birthday, I did my fifth step with my sponsor. And I sat in that seat waiting in that meeting for her to turn around and look at me, and I just smiled at her. And what happened was I just kind of owned my seat a little bit more in Alcoholics Anonymous from doing my first fifth step. And I've done a lot of fifth steps. I've had three sponsors in my 22 and a half years. My first one, I don't know where she is. God bless her. You know, she's sponsored me for well over 4 years. She took me from a little lost girl into the beginnings of a life. My second sponsor was a woman named Jenny, who was marvelous in helping me learn how to become a woman and learn how to own that part of me and learn how to not be afraid of it and to know I could be enough as a woman. See, a lot of those things I used to scoff at, I never thought I could do. I never thought I was enough. And Jenny got me to that point because I was able to be vulnerable with her, and she was so womanly and so wise, and she was so to the point with me, and she's back now in our group with 2 years of sobriety because she had started smoking pot, and she had to give up her time, and then she got some time, and then she drank, and she had a hard time, and 2 years of sobriety, and finally the light is on again. Finally. She's so lucky to be back. But the light wasn't on for a couple of years, and finally I saw it go back on. Finally. So I was so happy to see that for her. And I met this man, and he was a boy, I was a girl, and he had 6 more months than me, and we got together, Boy Meets Girl in AA Campus. We got married, we got engaged, we were engaged for a year, we got married. It was an AA wedding. My father came out, my mother came out, my sisters came out. They went to an AA meeting. They would whisper about me if I'm sharing an AA, you know, very loud. And now I go home, I'm home a couple of days, starting to, you know, sit in one chair, go sit in the other chair. They go, isn't it time to go to a meeting? I mean, they really are happy that they know where to send me to get calm. You guys have this calming effect on me. And, you know, now my dad walks down the street and goes, you know, my daughter went to AA in New Zealand, took her to, she went to New Zealand. And it's like, Dad, there's anonymity, you know. It's like something called anonymity, you know, because my friends will come up to me at class reunions and say, your father is, you know, it's like, great, you know, but they've seen me through it. They've seen me through it. I'm an example of Alcoholics Anonymous to them. Janet had me go home at a year of sobriety and start the amends with my father. And it was the beginning. And we stood by the car, I put my bags in, and we're going home. And I know, I'd been there a week, and I hadn't done it. And I knew she was going to ask. She never forgets. They go to sponsor school. Somehow they take these notes. I don't know. They know how to ask for more when you're willing, too. And I stood by the car, and I looked at my feet, and we were standing in sand, and I remember making holes in the sand with my toes. I remember saying to my father what I needed to say about making the amends of this program and starting to lead a different life, and that I was very sorry if I had hurt him. And I know I had said sorry a lot of times, and I was hoping to act differently and become a better member of this family. And some sort of speech I had written out that we had talked about, and my dad said, dude, I just always wanted you to have a good life and be happy, and that was it. There were no angels that sang. There was no earthquake that happened. There was no big hugging and crying and healing, but it was said. And I got in the car and I came home. She said, did you do it? And I said, yes. And it was a real big thing for me. And so when he came out to the wedding and he saw all of you and he went to a meeting, he said, Sharon, look at your life. You got it made. And I thought, wow, Dad's giving me approval here. He said, if you think about doing what you're doing before, think twice. And I had already had some of my own approval now by working the steps. Working the steps has given me worth. My first dot was Beacon's Moving Van because it was there, and I thought it would make my sponsor mad because she embarrassed me in front of some newcomers I was talking to with all of my prophetic advice at 6 months of sobriety, you know, and she embarrassed me, and so I picked my higher power, which is Beacon's Moving Van, and I got off the plane today, and there's a Beacon storage right over there, and I saw that, and I just went, oh, good, God is here. My son and I were lost up in the Arrowhead a couple weeks ago in fog. You couldn't even see him. We're trying to drive, and right beside us comes this big truck, B-E-K-I-N-S. Oh, we're going to be okay. See, I forget, you know. I forget I have this gratitude meter that forgets. I have to come to Alcoholics Anonymous to be reminded. I need to pray twice a day. I need to see Beacon fans. I need people to call me from Colorado going, I saw one today, how are you? You know? I need together. I need us. We can do what I can't do. The sponsor, Jimmy, said to me I was having some problems with my husband and I had finally owned my own character defects, which a lot was anger. Guess what? I was angry. I couldn't even, a short circuit came together one night when I hit him on the head with a flashlight. Oh my God, I'm angry. Let me call my sponsor, you know. I'm angry! And she was like excited and he was mad, but you know, we started working on my defects of character and said, you know, what about your relationship with your dad? I said, what does it have to do with my marriage? You know how they do. They pull out something totally different. She said, why don't you call your father up and ask him how much money you owe him? If you could pay him back that money you owe him. I said, I didn't take my inventory about the money with you. How did you know? Sponsor school. You know, that's where they go. And so I called up my dad and I asked him, and he had been to the wedding, been to a meeting, read the big book, ran a calculator tape, put it on page 79, which says most alcoholics owe money, and he said to my mother, if I'm out and Sharon calls, and she'll get to this part in the book if she stays sober, give her the bottom line, please. I know my dad did that. Because when I called him, he said, it's this much. He didn't even hesitate. And I was a little shocked. I called my sponsor. I had a new resentment. She said she didn't care, of course. And what happened was I called my father today. If he accepted my terms, I started sending him a check. And my sponsor wants more for me than I want for myself, because between me and my sponsor are there. Between me and me is my head. And my sponsor said to me, I want you to put a note with that check. Your father. A note about your life. I said, he's got three other professional children. What does he care about the drunk in Alcoholics Anonymous in sunny Southern California for? Well, the fruits and nuts roll out as far as he's concerned. She said, very lovingly, do it anyway. Because, you know, I've had sponsors that have pushed me and prodded me and led me and helped me and, you know, shored me up and moved me along when I have resisted. But the point is that I have done it. Even if I'm kicking and screaming, even if I don't believe it, my actions have brought me results, and my results have brought me freedom. And I sent my dad that check on time because she said, you're an example of the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous, and I paid attention to that. He got that check for 3 3/4 years on time with the note, and the note turned into letters, and Father's Day cards were easier to buy, and I remembered his birthday on time, and something had begun to change, and I didn't even realize it. The men's steps are so powerful. And what happened was my dad called me between Christmas and New Year's, picked up the phone, dialed the phone. He said, my husband handed me the phone. He said, it's your dad. I thought, my mom died. My dad never calls me. Now, I said, hello. And he said, Merry Christmas, no more checks. I don't want your money anymore. Your debt is free and clear. And he added the words that made all the difference, because of a sponsor that wanted more for me than I wanted for myself. He said, don't stop sending me your notes. And we started on a brand new relationship because of Alcoholics Anonymous at that moment. Now my dad is 80, and I go home every 4th of July. That's the time I like to go home and see my family, because I hate 4th of July in Southern California. They have fireworks at dawn. I mean, they're strange out there. Good AA, but they're strange out there. So I go home, and a few years ago, my dad had been through some surgeries, and we had one of those great 4th of Julys with, you know, the perfect parade and the perfect apple pie, and the watermelon was sweet, and, you know, I felt a part of that family, and we had an AA volleyball game, and then we went to the house, and we did sparklers and perfect fireworks, and, you know, the Milky Way was out. You could see the Milky Way, and the fireflies were doing their thing, and I was sweeping up after the sparklers were all over. My dad walked out to me, and he started sharing with me about his pain with the surgery and how he felt his purpose was waning in life and how hard it was getting older. And I went, oh my God, my dad is sharing with me. My first thought, because I'm selfish, self-centered alcoholic, was, oh good, I've been waiting to sponsor you. You know, help you in life. And but thank God I am in touch with my God, because my God's head, my God is louder than my head, because the next voice I heard said, just shut up and listen. And I did, and my dad has been sharing with me ever since then. So it just gets better. It just gets better. Every day, it's my prayer of whatever God, just get me out of the way and let me be of service. Page 77. Our purpose is to fit ourselves to be a maximum service to God and the people about us. That's truth. That's what I've looked for my whole life. It's that simple for me. In 1984, I had a little baby boy. I never thought I could do that. I got to name him Wesley after my grandfather. I got to close that circle. I got divorced when my son was a year and a half old, and I had been to Al-Anon before. Thank God it saved the marriage. I think I had a child because of that. He had a problem being faithful, and even though I didn't really know it, I knew it. But we hung in there. We went to Al-Anon, both of us. We worked on it. I had the baby. Things were really good. I went back to the church. I was sponsoring this nun. And then in January of 86, he decided he wanted this newcomer, and he didn't want to be married anymore. And he's got 23 years. He stayed sober. Nobody had to get drunk, thank God. But it hurt like hell. I had was really happy in my life. I was really had gotten better jobs. I got to retire and have a little 401k going so that I could enjoy my child and be a mom and a housewife and go to meetings and work with others. And they left. And I couldn't lay down and be the doormat like I used to be because I wasn't that person anymore. I was full of God. I wasn't full of self-loathing. And Jenny, my sponsor then, was smoking the pot, and I had to go get a new sponsor. I ended up at Clancy's door, knocking on his door with my baby in the stroller going something like, I don't think you like me, I don't like you, but I need help. And he said, come in and sit down. And thank God he was louder than my head. You get a sponsor louder than your head. Because they were across the room one night, seemingly having a very nice, fun Saturday night, and it was date night, and there I was alone again, feeling sorry for me, and I was doing things like 10 years of sobriety. I was cutting off all my hair, dyeing it little short, white, spiky things, and driving my car to Sacramento to go to a meeting and taking newcomers with me and not stopping to let anybody go to the bathroom. It's a four-hour trip, you know? Shut up, you know? And every time Bruce Springsteen would come on the radio, I'd sob. It was just, you know, but I hung in there. Nobody was going to get my seat in AA. I was shoplifting, driving my car fast. I was crazy. And my sponsor happened to be there that night when I was walking across the room with two hot cups of coffee to really see how happy those two were in the corner of the room. I was going to throw them on him. And Clancy happened to see where I was going and what I was doing, and he stopped me and he took the coffee out of my hands. He put them on the table. He grabbed me by the shoulders and he looked in my eyes and he said, Sharon, you will walk through this with dignity and grace. And, you know, I wasn't ready for that. I was still into revenge, but he added the words louder than my head so that you can be an example to others. And I heard him, and I told on myself that I had to go make amends to the Broadway for shoplifting. I had to stop driving my car fast. I had to start eating and sleeping and writing an inventory and go get a job and act like a human being again. And what happened was 1 year, 1 month, and 18 days, I walked through the new door into a beautiful view, and I've never looked back. I've never looked back. Now, this girl and I became good friends because she had a little baby boy, and my son wanted to be with his brother. And I started to like her, and I didn't want to like her, but I started to like her. And my sponsor made me take my son over there to be with her kid. And, you know, I give her a cake every birthday. And she gives me a cake at my women's meeting every birthday. And we've been better friends now that they've been divorced a few years, so that's that worked out good. But, you know, she said to me, I knew I could do it when he left me for her, because you had. So it's none of my business why I'm thrown in the fire. My job is to get up and walk and quit feeling sorry for myself and find out why you're in the hallway too. And he's happy with his Al-Anon, and he had a heart attack when he was 40, 41 years old, and we went to see him in the hospital, and we had made our amends. Things were okay. I had this great guy in my life who's sober 15 years. We had a lot of fun together. He has a story like mine. Our relationship is based on the gratitude of the Spirit, and there's a lot of passion and gratitude. It's an amazing thing. And we don't live together. I've been raising my kid. He's been building a career. I've been building a career. We do a lot of Alcoholics Anonymous, and we have a great time, but we're very committed to each other. Just not ready to get married again. I'm just not, and it's okay. Now, so what happened was he had this heart attack. We went to see him in the hospital, and I was fine with my ex, and he was sitting there in a trance. Cindy was there reading him the big book, and he always tubes, and I lost it. And my son was talking to his dad, and he was fine, and I lost it. And what happened was he started to have leg cramps, and he started to panic, and he was having leg cramps, and he wanted to pull the tubes out. And so what I did was I just started to rub out his leg cramps. such a deep service here. And a healing came over me, and I wished that man well, and I wished that man everything he ever wanted from life. And I was able to walk away freer that day because you taught me how to be of service. When I don't know what else to do, be of service. Go find a newcomer. Pick up the phone and see how somebody else is doing. I have a really great life today. I have a really great kid. I've been at a job for 11 years at a law firm where I walk in and stand toe-to-toe with Harvard Yale graduates, and they listen to me because you've taught me how to hold my head up and look at people in the eye and feel like I'm God's kid. And I know where the power is. The power is in God. The power is in love. The power is in God with skin on in Alcoholics Anonymous. I need to come here and feel it every night. I need to have contact with a member of Alcoholics Anonymous. I get to sponsor a lot of people. I got to go back to New Orleans and make amends to that town. I get to sponsor a girl that used to drink with me. Another girl that we used to drink together from my past in New Orleans went and got me a fully pardoned piece of paper from the state of Louisiana and mailed it to me because she went back to law school in sobriety. So I am a pardoned felon. I don't have to write that down anymore. Freedom is Alcoholics Anonymous. Freedom is a God that loves me much more than I could ever love myself. Freedom is getting on an airplane and coming to be with you this weekend to feel God with skin on and to see the light in your eyes so that I know one more time, that's just by seconds and inches, that we are the lucky ones. Thank you very much for listening to me.